Psalms 23, beginning at verse 1. You've probably never heard this before. Psalms 23, beginning at verse 1. Now, here's what you got to do for me if we're going to roll together today. You got to not check out on me just because you've heard Psalms 23. Because God wants to bring something out of the Psalms that you ain't heard or I wouldn't be preaching. So I want you to pretend for the next 20, 30 minutes of time that you've never heard this before. Act like it's all new to you. Act like it's all fresh to you. And watch what God does in your mind and in your understanding. Psalms 23, beginning of verse 4. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Notice it's him and not us. Him and not us. How many of you are stressed out today because you think it's all on you and a little bit of him? And Jesus said, I'm the vine, you're the branches. Apart from me, you can do nothing. It's the lie of the devil that gets you stressed out all the time. He restored my soul. He led me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I want to preach it this morning a little while from the subject of the shepherd. Because so many times we get caught up in the hustle and bustle of life and of church and of family that we forget there is a shepherd that the Bible says is a good shepherd that looks over our life. And the enemy loves nothing more than to take people that belong to God and stress them out with the cares and the worries and their weaknesses and struggles to where they can't enjoy their relationship with Jesus and they can't enjoy their relationship with each other. The enemy tries to bombard us so that we forget that we have a God that looks over us when we can't even look over ourselves. That we have a God sometimes that kept us from doing the wrong thing even when we wanted to, just because it's his job to protect us even more than it is our job to stay out of trouble. I know you're having a hard time being honest this morning, but if he ever got you out of a jam, you ought to give him a praise anyhow. If he ever made a way for you, you ought to give him. If he ever did anything for you, you ain't got to tell what it is, but you ought to make some noise that it happened. The Bible didn't say he's a bad shepherd. The Bible said he is a good shepherd in describing my Jesus. Somebody just say my Jesus. My Jesus. It said my Jesus will leave the 99 and go for the one. It ain't talking about your preacher. It's talking about your Savior. He is able to go for that one that nobody can find. That one that's so far out and so broken and made so many mistakes. God said, I know how to bring them back. Ooh, I feel my help coming early. I just want you to know today, no matter where you are on life's journey, what mistakes you made, what things dwell between your ears, my Savior knows how to get you back. Though if man knew everything about you, they'd leave you out there on that island. God said, not me. I come from my sheep. If he's ever came for you, you ought to give him a praise right now. If you've ever got stuck, he's a good shepherd, man. He'll come looking for you. When you made some wrong choices, I know I'm preaching to people that are God's second cousin, and you ain't made no wrong choices. But just in case you ever meet somebody that did, you need to tell them that Jesus is able to come looking for them. In fact, the only reason you're here today and you're alive and not dead is because the shepherd kept his hand on you. The shepherd came looking for you. Some of you were in a crack house, but he came looking for you. Some of you had done left church, but he came looking for you. Some of you had contemplated suicide, but he came looking for you. Some of you wouldn't be here today, but the good shepherd came looking for you. Somebody's sitting here today and they don't understand your praise. They don't understand why you're here, because they're wondering if the good shepherd will love them the way he loves you. Their problem, the trick of life is the voice of the enemy always trying to make you feel like your problem and your mistakes are greater than your shepherd. The devil is a lie. David said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Scholars and theologians believe that he wrote this at one of the darkest times of his life. I believe it was at that moment David looked at all the things God had brought him through.
and all the things that God had delivered him from. And David knew that it hadn't been his strength, it hadn't been his intelligence, that the only reason he had made it that far was God had loved him more than anything. Is there anybody that's ever looked over your life and you said, that's why I walked away from the car wreck. That's why I got over the nervous breakdown. That's why I made it through the divorce. That's why I'm still here. You ought to make a sound right now that lets somebody know your shepherd is greater than your sin. Come on, somebody. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want to. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the stool. It didn't say he asked me if I won't go. The Bible gives the description of a good shepherd grabbing you by the nape of the neck and making you. See, when God is in your life, there'll be times you want to go the wrong way and you think, I want to go there. God said, no, I know where I'm taking you. Yeah. Some of you feel like you're lost on the journey. But what makes a good shepherd is he leads the sheep even when they don't know he's around. Ain't that just like the presence of Jesus, that he's able to lead us through the ups and the downs and the pitfalls of life? The Bible said that he restoreth my soul. I just want somebody to know today that the good shepherd is able to put back in you what life took out of you. Have you ever been through a relationship and it took something out of you? Have you ever been through a struggle and it took something out of you? Oh, y'all. Have you ever been through anything and it took something out of you? God said, I'm able to put it back in you. He's able to restore your joy and restore your smile, restore your peace, and restore your family. The Bible said, he restoreth my soul. There have been times and seasons in all of our life that we needed the good shepherd to restore what that thing took out of us, what that relationship took out of us, what that mistake took out of us. So my shepherd is big enough to restore your soul. Now I want you to watch what else he does. The Bible says that he leads you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. See, God has this thing that people are watching you and you're a direct reflection of him. When the kids were little, Carlene wouldn't let them. Now we can't really keep them from wearing what they want to wear. We try to, Mickey, but it's harder when they get up bigger. But now Jake, I remember when he was a little boy, it was one Easter Sunday, and he was about four. And he had, Carlene, I don't know what was going on in her, you know, God has moved. But have you ever seen, what those things called that you have in you?
Knickers.
And Jake had a speech impediment, as y'all know, he couldn't talk. And he's 4 years old, and I heard him walking down the steps, and he was crying. And I was like, Dad. And so I didn't know if he failed, knocked his teeth out, what. So I came running to the bottom of the stairs, and he couldn't explain it to me because he couldn't talk. But he stood there in those plaid shorts and those knickers and those little cute shoes, and he just went, like, Dad, look at the mess Mama put me in. I walked upstairs, I said, Carlene, the devil is a liar. You ain't never dressing my boy like that again. Amen, I got some love in here. Jake ought to be amen to me right now, too. But Carlene wanted to reflect her love by the way he dressed, by the way he acted. God is the same way with us. He wants it to be that when people look at you, they see what a good God he is. Right. That when people look at you, they see how faithful he is. That when people look at you, they know that your God is able. He said, I'll deliver you not for your sake, but for my name's sake. I just come to prophesy to somebody. God's going to bring you out of this pit, not because you were good enough, but because he was good enough. Because people are looking at you, and they're going to glorify him for what he does in you. I wish I had some people that have ever needed God to get them out. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through. Everybody say through. Amen. I got good news and I got bad news. I'll give you the bad news first. You're going to go through the valley of the shadow of death. Can I give you the good news? You're going to go through the valley of the shadow of death. You're going to make it because of your good shepherd. This season's going to end, and a new season's, I don't know who I'm preaching to, but God just wanted me to remind somebody, you're not going to die in that valley. It's not always going to be that way. You are on your way to a better day. If you needed that out there, just stand to your feet and give him about a 10-second praise. Because you're coming out of that depression. You're coming out of that. God, you're coming out. and keep your eyes on him. Throw that picture up for me, Sherry. I want you to look at this. Did you know? Look at the pitiful little sheep. I mean, I wish God would call us like Bigfoot, Sasquatch. But when Jesus talked about us, he referred to you and me. I want to be like Arnold. I don't want to be like that. But Jesus said, my sheep. Did you know that sheep, just leave that the rest of the time, we're going to work far out of that. Did you know that sheep are the only animals on earth that cannot survive without sheep? Even snickerdoodle dogs and poodles and kitty cats can make it without a shepherd. But sheep are so helpless, left to their own, they would be eradicated from planet Earth. They're the only known animal that cannot survive without a shepherd. Is it not interesting that when Jesus talked about you and me, he said we were sheep and he was the shepherd. Could it be he is telling us the only way we have survived is because he has taken care of us? The only reason we're still alive is because he has been good to us. And the only way I can make it into my tomorrow is if the good shepherd go with me. Yeah. Look at these sheep. I mean, which one would I pick out if I had to be one? None. Told Ben, I said, give me a picture of the sheep. Our flock. Ben's always real creative. This is what we got. When I saw it, I saw the black sheep. I felt the Holy Ghost on that black sheep. Because that's the one that sticks out. That black sheep is deemed as the oddball. I believe God called me to preach to the black sheep.
Come on.
I believe God called me to preach to the one that feels like they don't fit in. Help me, Holy Ghost. I believe God called me to preach to the one that sits there today and says, if they knew what I really struggled with, if they knew what I really went through, they wouldn't want me. I just want somebody to know that God is a God of the black sheep. God is a God of the outcast. God is a God of the misfit. God is a God of the failure. You don't believe me, but in the book of Exodus, he came to the black sheep named Moses and said, I'm going to use you even though you're a murderer to deliver my people. It was God that raised up King David. His daddy had no confidence in him, but God said, I can use you even if you're the black sheep. And I'm preaching to somebody today that God wants me to tell you that he specializes in raising up the black sheep. God specializes in using the one that feels like they're the least in the room. God specializes in putting his hand on the one that feels like they don't fit in. Feels like they don't belong. That's afraid to reach out to God because you're afraid God don't really like you. You're afraid God don't really love you. God brought you here for me to tell you he specializes in blessing the black sheep. He specializes in raising up the outcast. The Bible said he leads us in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Let me stop right there. There are people in your life that see you like the black sheep. I wish I had a nickel for every person that sees me as a preacher and they say I don't fit in because I don't dress the way they want me to dress. And I didn't come from the pedigree of preacher lineage they wanted me to. And I don't say it the way they want me to say it. And I don't do it the way they want me to do it. I can't tell you how many people I've got to see me as the black sheep, but all their rejection did was make me hold closer on to him. And every time they shut a door in my face, God opened up his arms. And I just come to tell somebody that my God's got you right now. I dare you to praise him. And if you've ever felt like the outcast, if you've ever felt like you didn't fit in, if you've ever felt like you didn't belong, you found your home, baby.
God says, I prepare a table before you, not in the absence of the enemy, but in the presence of the enemy. God said, I'll do a work for you. Not where people can't see it because I don't want to know how good I am to you. God said, I'll love on you right in front of them. God said, I'll do things to blow their mind. He said, I'll prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. David said, you anoint my head with oil. David was always talking about oil and anointing in the head. Because David understood that the battle we fight
is always between our ears. David understood the greatest battle we would ever fight in life would not be out here with Goliaths or demons or all these things. The biggest battle you fight, my friend, is right between your ears. The biggest battle I fight is right between my ears. The biggest battle we all fight is right between our ears. And David said, the good thing about my shepherd is he knows how to anoint my head. David said, cover my head in the day of battle. David said, there's going to be times in life that fear tries to get my mind. There's going to be times in my life that oppression and depression try to grip my mind. He said, but I know a good shepherd that knows how to apply fresh anointing to my mind and drive that away. Have you ever come to church? And he said, I just need to hear something that helps my mind. I've got kids acting crazy. I've got bills going amok. I've got the enemy lying to me. I see hopelessness all around me. But by the time God got done with you, you left there saying, you know what? I'm going to make it. You know what? My God is on my side. If you've ever needed fresh oil for your head, I need you to get my head clapped right now. Maybe I'm the only crazy one in here, but I needed God to touch my head many times. When fear tried to overtake me, when the lies of the enemy tried to bury me, I put my head in his presence and he gives me fresh oil. The Bible said, surely, not maybe, surely, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days. Somebody say, all the days. All the days of my life, I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. He also said, I brought my staff, they comfort me. Now watch this. God shows himself as a good shepherd. He says, I got you, Mikey. I'm preaching to people. Some of you I grew up with. Some of you I've known. And I love you. I love what God's made you. But when I look over at this church, I see a lot of people that felt just like me at one point in life. You felt like the outcast. You felt like the oddball. Could it be that God let you feel like that so that you could be drawn to him? How many people do we have in churches all across America today that are going to leave feeling like the black sheep? Feeling like, oh, that church don't want me. Oh, that Jesus, he can't help me because I got a problem they don't know about. I got a struggle I can't talk about. That's why I try to kick it down into low gear to where I can get to somebody that religion ain't getting to. Because I'm preaching to some people here today that there's a loop lie going on in your mind and it's on replay telling you every reason why God can't bless you. Telling you every reason why you should give up. Telling you every reason why you should be hopeless. And I'm telling you one reason why all that's a lie. Because I know Jesus and he is greater. But I know what it's like to sit there and think, oh, if they knew me. If they knew what I was going through. If they knew what I was struggling. But one thing about the black sheep is it's easy to identify. Automatically, your attention was drawn to the one sheep that stood out. Could it be that sometimes it is your pain that draws the attention of the Spirit of God to deliver you? Not that thing that's like everybody else, but that thing you went through that others don't understand. That's what made God come to you and snatch you up and say, I'm going to do something special in you. See, everybody serves God in a powerful way. It's because they had a spot in their life that they can't talk about. Yeah. You're going to sit there like, not me. I don't drink, cuss, chew, date girls that do, boo-hoo, boo-hoo. Liar, liar, pants on fire. Everybody had a moment. Everybody's got a struggle. Everybody's got a need for a Savior. And I don't worry about the ones that know it. I worry about the ones that don't.